Hi, everybody. It's okay to say hi back. I've been working on that for 10 years. It's coming. Welcome, and thank you very much, all of you, for being here. We realize it's a Saturday, and many of our families are pulled in all different directions, but it's terrific that we're able to bring such a great group together and a fine program, I think you'll agree at the end of the day, to honor our dear friend Anne. We find ourselves, speaking for myself and I know for some of my colleagues, wanting to turn to Anne, dialing her extension, ready to ask yet another question, ready to bring some sort of a budgetary question or requisition, or looking for some good advice. But we know Anne's in a better place, and she's alive in heaven and within us and among us now and forever. This was a really special time of year for Anne. As any of you know who worked with Anne or whose children worked with Anne, or if you were lucky enough to be one of Anne's students, there was just a special energy about Anne at the start of the school year. And what children saw in Anne's eyes is what we would hope for all of our kids all the time. That love and respect, eagerness to know them and understand them and help them in any way that she could. She was full of great gifts, and she lived her life in a purposeful, generous, loving way. And I know each of us here has been touched by Anne, her gestures, her words. My own relationship started off on a bit of a humorous note about 10 years ago, almost to the day. I think I was in my office with one of our administrators. I can't recall whether it was Natalie Hall, our lower school head at the time, or Nancy Kaplan, our middle school head. And we were talking about some important aspect of Burgundy culture or history. And we were going back and forth a little bit, seeking some understanding. And here comes a voice from behind the closed door, the other side of my door, up near Kathy Gerton's desk. And it said something like, "Well, actually," I can't imitate Anne's voice, but I think you can hear it. And of course, she was dead on with whatever the point was. And as the years grew on, I recognized how often I would be turned to Anne to better understand some point of our history or culture. Anne was an exemplary teacher among exemplary teachers. And I think it was embarrassing almost how often I found myself turning and using her as an example. But I don't think anybody begrudged that, because she truly brought it every day, every year, for more than 30 years. And you helped me, you inspired me. I'm so grateful that our friendship grew through the years, including through this past year. I think we all learned a lot from Anne, even in these past 12 or 15 difficult months. Anne, you continue to inspire us to be and do our best. We love you. Thank you for loving us. Today's program, you won't be surprised, was approved by Anne. That's a fact. And when I asked Anne what she might like included or not included, she was pithy and to the point. Music. Make sure there's lots of music. So indeed, there will be lots of music. But we're going to talk some and sing some and laugh some and probably cry a little bit. And it's going to be great. And I know that Anne's looking down. Please. I borrowed the gals from the library today, both to distract me a little bit, but to give us all courage up here to speak from the heart and remember that this is all for Anne and not for Anne. Typical of Burgundy, there's a few deviations from the program. Don't be upset by that. At one point, between What a Wonderful World and You're Gonna Make Me Lonesome, we'll invite anyone who's not on the program who'd like to come up and briefly say a few words to come up. You can just come up when we make the call and line up. And we just ask that you be brief, particularly if there's several people. And toward the end, Kathy Manley will lead us together in a fitting song as well. So I want to thank you all again. I'm going to introduce only the first speakers and then to just pay attention to the program. If you're on the program, you're coming up here when it's your turn. But current and past teachers, Carrie, Ustun, Carol Schwartz, and Eloise Singh are going to begin the formal part of the program. Again, we're glad you're here. If you haven't been here in a while, the bathroom's just under the basket here. You need one in the water fountain as well. Thanks.
Yes, the tears are flowing, but what an incredible day here. This is an Anne day, if ever I saw one. I got here a little bit early, and I was able to go out and stand on a deck, and it's almost out here like you're standing on the bow of a ship, looking out into the trees, and just lovely, and it was just watching some of the leaves coming down, and I felt that connection with you right here. Papa Jim, Jan, Larry, Caitlin, and Jesse, I know you're up there with your posse. It is really, truly a very special honor to be standing here right now. I'm on my tippy toes, so I'm gonna see if I can go down a little bit. I don't feel like my balance is that good today. So, Anne is here, right here in our midst. And I'm going to invite folks right now to just take a couple of minutes to just look around you, turn to your neighbor, your friend, your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your colleague, and just take them in, acknowledge that they're here. Anne would want that. She needs us to be here each and every moment. Close your eyes if you wish and just take a couple of deep breaths. I know I need those. I saw Anne in front of people doing tough things, necessary things. She was such a diligent, hardworking person who drove us to join her in questioning hard things, important things here in this community. Being in a family can sometimes be messy work, and she was never afraid to dive in. Her memory was to the point, as Jeff mentioned. She would just bring right back to the straight facts, ma'am. And she always knew when I had my overdue library books and exactly who, when, where they were. I think I have them all back, Anne. You know, Anne probably would have been up most of the night last night baking, preparing some dish for an event like this. She was always such a doer and such an inspiration in that way. She and Jim would be the first ones at the Cove. You'd be slicing and dicing before anybody had even left their house in Alexandria. And we'd arrive needing coffee. She'd always remind us to bring our coffee mugs. And there'd be a beautiful frittata, this gourmet meal, fresh fruit, a berry cobbler, muffins, all done through the love of Anne and Jim. As a young teacher, I was so blown away on my very first day of teacher work days in 1987. I arrived in my little dress thinking, okay, well, this is an important thing. Here I am launching my career. I'd just gotten out of college and walked into my very first meeting. It was going to be really fun. wanted to work at a school that had a farm, barnyard, cool. Well, Anne was one of the most vocal people during those first meetings. And, you know, speaking her mind, speaking her truth, not afraid. And as a newbie teacher, feeling kind of nervous, really nervous, that was a huge impression on me. It's time to listen. It's time to be the very best that we can be. And she strove for that over and over and over again. A very big impression. Each morning when I'd arrive at Burgundy, I'd see her gray owl truck right there. And I knew she was always the first one here. Going in to open up her treasure trove of a library. And then later on, as she brought her two granddaughters to school, and it just would feel like this really strong presence was already here, just working and caring, and like the breakfast treat of knowing that Anne and her granddaughters were here opening the school, saying good morning for all the kids. Anne and her sweaters and her earrings, every holiday theme covered. And of course, owls. I would come in, you know, around the fall time of year, pumpkins and scarecrows, Christmas sweaters, and the spring colors. Just never afraid to really make her mark. So, Anne as a master teacher, passionate librarian, stalwart guide through all the curriculum and accreditation work that we did, a wise woman warrior who endured the vicissitudes of this school, our changing and evolving school, growing, questioning, and then her courage through her marathon with cancer. I have a lot of notes here. Some more impressions. I never heard Anne say anything critical about anyone, any colleague or leader of the school, anyone on the board. She'd have her opinions, I knew, but she kept them under close wrap, didn't want to spread negativity into an already jam-packed bunch of emotions. That made an impression very quickly on a young teacher. She'd always have your back. She'd support your teaching in any way she could. Oftentimes I'd find a pile of books on my table, my teacher table, waiting for me. Oh, I heard you found a monarch chrysalis. Here's a whole bunch of books about the monarch. Sounds like you better get some books going for Santa Lucia Day. So just didn't want you to fail. She supported your growth as a teacher, a real working colleague. Blankets for new parents. John and I, as we were expecting our first kiddo, the teachers threw us a shower, a baby shower, and Anne made two of these beautiful gender soft as a downy chick flannel with sateen edging, and they're treasures in our family. I keep them kind of guarded now. I did bring them into our classroom for the housekeeping area for bears and other little guys. So, I had the great and amazing pleasure of teaching both Jesse and Caitlin. And I remember Anne coming down every morning, dropping Jesse off in her red outfit, always red in JK. And Anne would be kind of looking through. through the window, wondering if Jesse was going to be okay, and we'd wave at Grammy, and she'd wave back with a thumbs up, everything was good. And then a couple of years later, Caitlin got to come to JK. Well, it was a totally different scene. Caitlin was there before Grammy even left the library most mornings, and she'd come in giggling and happy as a clam, and of course Grammy would eventually show up and, oh, looks like Caitlin's going to have a great day. Sure enough. So, you are her mini-me, too. Pumpkin breads, cranberry breads at Thanksgiving and for Christmas, and always found a way to show her appreciation for us teachers. And boy, were we lucky to have the Van Dusen and Wajada families in our midst. Never anything that we didn't ask for that came back in just generosity. And you were our Burgundy mama, our Grammy, inspiring us and guiding us to remember all the important stuff. You're not afraid to lead us. You're still leading us through all of the guidance that you gave us and what you taught us how to be. Thank you for your true grit. Thank you for everything that you've given to me, to us, and to our Burgundy family community. I love you guys.
Sometimes forgot that the Great Alexandria Library was not in ancient Egypt. It was in Anne's head right here. There's so much of Burgundy right now that we enjoy because of Anne. A magnificently cataloged library. We could always find what we wanted thanks to Anne and her enthusiasm for cataloging. This is a rare passion even among librarians. Fluid integration of digital media and paper resources, cove buildings that stand because she and Jim took them on when no one else was there, pens on Lucy addresses, Jesse and Caitlin, and astounding catalog contributions. Anne was also a woman of conviction. And you don't have conviction without strong opinions. At her retirement in June, the faculty, assisted by two granddaughters and a time machine, tried to whisk Anne through a pastiche covering nearly four decades of her contributions to Burgundy. Hubris on our part. We stopped off at the time there was a request for the books, which might have had too much factual information for children, not to mention illustrations. We applauded Anne for defending her shelves. In the middle of our presentation, she looked at us, as only Anne could do, and said, requested? Those books weren't requested. Those books were taken. But I got them back. Strengthened by her convictions, possibly the best seasonal sweater collection on campus, and could always move forward. Where others saw limitations and roadblocks, Anne saw possibilities. When we brought a new idea to Anne, she always understood the intent, the implications, and immediately offered resources and possibilities. Anne saw possibilities in people they didn't always see in themselves, not elusive potential that you had to act right now possibilities. Anne saw possibilities in children.
He didn't always see his parents.
She never criticized. She never said, why didn't you? She said, well, you could, and then rolled off the catalog of possibilities and offered to help. As one teacher noted, from my first day teaching at Burgundy, Anne supported me in a manner I can't quite put my finger on, but it was most definitely unconditional. Our students felt this, all of us who work here felt it. Anne's legacy at Burgundy may be too vast, even for the most Annish among us, to catalog. I think, though, we can maintain her legacy by continuing to look for possibilities.
I'm Eloise Singh, a former teacher here, and I think I'm speaking as the one who was here with Anne. Next to the loft in a nice little small room, very sunny, with a nice collection and a story novel. Well, Anne has said herself that she wrote the library most certainly for the mission. The collection is probably one of the best of any school possible to have. She encouraged our group. She knew all the areas of the curriculum. She was probably the main person who could tell you what each of us was teaching. Planning and supplies and execution. Big computers, personal computers began to come on the scene. Well, all of us were scrambling to learn how to use computers. Anne not only supported us, but brought into the library and started a whole setup of computers and teaching children how to do research and gain information. We were all learning together and it was really impressive. Everybody's mentioned how much she knew about the books and how she was able to link children with books. I can't imagine how she found the time to read all those books, in addition to all of the professional work, family work, community work. It was really amazing. Sometimes some of us would come up with sort of odd curriculum things we wanted to do. I know we did ancient Egypt. That was not at the time a subject taught in the elementary schools. It now is, but Anne was instrumental in finding materials that were appropriate and used and modified in the classroom. I was most grateful. About code, and I know we'll talk about it more. She immediately connected when she realized what it was. And at that time, we didn't have the wonderful staff and program we have now, so a lot of us teachers were involved in setting up the programs for our classes as we went up there. And then we had the faculty retreats. Well, Anne saw that we needed some help, and she was right up there even getting Jim to come and cook omelets for us for breakfast, which was wonderful. And she also encouraged us to do professional growth. So a number of us went up to the New England Library Association to hear some of the top children's authors speak. We all talked, not just class. Her ability to organize large mammoth projects. She took on the job of getting supplies, pushed some of us for a little slow and getting our computers in and deciding what we were doing next year. Came in over the summer and unpacked and organized all the supplies and checked out what wasn't there. She also took several times that I know of running the getting ready for accreditation. Talk about her with cats. She has simply left us with a legacy that we can be proud of. And it was always fun to stop in the library and have a chat with Anne to catch up on what was going on around school. And also, as a fellow teacher's
love of my old students. It just seems like yesterday that we had the graduation party for Anne, and everybody was, you know, very effusive about what she's been like. So I'm going to say a little bit of that, but also make it a little more personal. It said we've indeed been fortunate to have Anne Van Deusen as our in our community and as our librarian for 34 years, and her energy and her many for her job and many other duties, as well as pushing forward the mission of the school, has just was a constant as Burgundy went through 30 years of change since we've been here. I have a little anecdote, and I've been trying to decide whether to tell it or not, but if Jim will forgive me and his family. It starts in 1915. My mother was born in 1915, and in 1918, her father died of the flu, and she grew up with her grandmother and her mother in her maiden aunt. She went to college in Potsdam, New York, in 1933, and boarded with Margaret and Marshall Frenette. Now, Margaret and Marshall had four daughters. It was Mary and Anne and Jane and Jean, who were twins. She had never had a family life or siblings. She was an only child. And Margaret taught her everything, how to iron, how to cook, how to take care of younger children. She babysat for Mary and Anne and Jean and Jane, and had chicken pox in college with Mary and the younger girls. And so she missed them so much when she went home on summer break that she'd come back for summer school just so she could be with the Frenettes. So all my life, I've heard about the Frenettes. Well, Mary went on. Mary grew up. They went their separate ways. Mary grew up, got married, married at James Van Deusen, and lived in Cobleskill. And I first met Anne in 1982. And in 1980, it took to about 1986 when we figured that she had married Mary Frenette Van Deusen's oldest son, Jim. And I had all their family pictures. My mother got them every Christmas from Margaret or Mary. And I really, it was a very important folklore in our family. And the fact that we would end up working together as adults for all the years we did. And I said that because I have a captive audience, but it just shows the connections that we all have together that, you know, make it so much fun to meet new people and to work with new people and to share life with people. Anyway, I shall leave that there. There's a lot of other things. My mother just turned 100 and still talks about Margaret and Marshall and Mary and in fact, she used to write her, Potsdam was a teaching school, and she used to write her child development stories about Jean and Jane, the twins. Anne was a very multifaceted person, as we all know. There was nothing that she could not be. Except, as I said before, reading horror stories. She farmed those out. She loved romance, though.
my favorite being the wine from Le Tapo, you so generously carried in your suitcases. And birding was another passion, and when they traveled, they would try to explore as many bird watching areas as they could with their big telescope, birding telescope. Jan loved to sew, as we all know, but she didn't just sew costumes and things like that. She made Jan's dresses and wedding gowns and all that. For Jane, she made his boxer shorts, which Larry might have a few of those too. I don't know. Out of very crazy material, let me say. and the baby blankets, and as I say, for every friend, acquaintance, colleague, relative, acquaintance, relatives, she had these on hand the minute she heard a baby was born. Yep, she'd have it delivered. My nieces and nephews have them all. And my grandchildren. She loved jigsaw puzzles, as do I, and which may be a qualification for a librarian, I don't know, and was a great card player, and she and Jim were in a bridge club that met regularly. Now, I'm focusing on all the things she did in her personal life, while remember how many things she took on in her professional life, but she's doing all that. Now, high on her bucket list for retirement was working on her family tree. And I shared with her, I had been doing that as well, and I was sharing her my research experience and how I organize my information. And she, that was just up her alley. She was really desperate. And I haven't talked to her about that in the last few years. I don't know if she made any progress on that at all. But that was her on her bucket list. To do that. Gardening was a passion, and on top of everything else happening in the month of June, she always made time to make strawberry preserves. And she would use them as gifts throughout the year. And her garden was such that the deer and the raccoon and the rabbits, they just loved her backyard. Now, for the first decade I knew her in the 1980s, as her obligations became more and more numerous, her mantra became, I just have to learn to say no. I just have to learn to say no. But I don't think it was in her nature at all. She wanted to try new things. And she wanted to be involved and to organize things. As somebody else mentioned, she loved to organize, and she was so good at it, both at school and in her home life, up to the very end. And James, her son, told me that the pictures in video of her, I don't know whether that's going to be shown here, were chosen by her. They went through all the albums, and Anne chose all of the pictures. Her life was full, and she did not postpone her interests for when I have more time. She made time for them in her already full life, somehow. I don't know how she did it all. Burgundy will be forever grateful for her vision and her contributions and her profound dedication to our school. Thank you, Anne, and go in peace.
wanted to give an opportunity for anyone who would like to come up and say even a word or phrase that you'd like to share with the group, or a quick anecdote. It's certainly fine if no one is feeling the inspiration, but in speaking with the family, we wanted to provide this opportunity. So now's your opportunity. Come on up, don't be shy, it's perfectly great. We'll hold it to about 5 minutes, so if anyone's feeling that inspiration, this is your chance. If not, after we're done, the whole program is going to be an opportunity to mingle. But good, tiny room. How lovely. It's great to see so many faces here, but yours especially.
I was not part of Burgundy for a very short time, but in that short time, something very special happened between Anne and me. She was the first person almost who greeted me on campus in 2008, and I saw immediately sort of a luminosity about her that played out in 100 different ways over the next 3 years. And one of the best memories I have is the faculty singers singing This Little Light of Mine, I'm gonna let it shine. So life supremely well lived. Well done, Anne.
My name is Chuck Wager. I'm a former parent here, and my wife teaches second grade now. She used to teach first grade before we moved to Vermont and then to get back. Anyway, my story about Anne, we first encountered Anne when our daughter was in JK here many years ago, and the library was, of course, where the music room is now. Vicki, my wife, volunteered in the library with our son, Matt, who was at that time newborn, more or less, and we were just both impressed that anybody would let that kind of thing happen in school. But that's not what I wanted to talk about. Some years later, when the library was moving to where it is now, Dave Miller and I, Dave is the computer guy who preceded Joe Peacock, Dave Miller and I were wiring the building for computers, and I went to Anne, and I said, how many computer outlets do you want, and where do you want them? She said, we want computer outlets everywhere. Computers are as important as books. And I said, wow, that is very progressive for somebody. I thought it was just a librarian who cares about books. And I was just, several people here have spoken how versatile she was and how amazing she grasped things. And that's just one more example of that. That's really what I wanted to say. But I wanted to say one more thing. Because Anne impacted so many people here. Everybody in this room Anne impacted, and many thousands who aren't in this room. A lot of people have talked about how organized she was, and how efficient she was, and how she got things done, and how she learned about things, but more important, I think, was how caring she was. She was one of the most caring and loving people I have ever met. Every student, she knew every student, she cared for every student, and that, to me, is even more impressive than her organization, which was also impressive. But just, she was such a caring person, and we'll miss her so, so much.
Changed it around.
research and things like that, but it wasn't until fifth grade, and then Deusen took over, that I learned how to use a paper card catalog and how to read the Dewey Decimal System. Anne was very instrumental in a lot of students' lives here at Burgundy. Fast forward many years, and I ended up on the board as an alumni representative. It was on the board that I learned how involved Anne was, and she actually ran the VAIS accreditation, the big ones every 10 years and the little ones every 5 years. Most people may not realize how important that is to Burgundy. Burgundy needs to stay an accredited school, needs to have wonderful accreditations. It's a review process that not only makes us a school that meets a certain standard in the eyes of the rest of the world from an education standpoint, but it is an incredibly self-guiding process that has the school go through asking itself very tough questions. I can't imagine a better person to have done that for the school for so long. She was great about facilitating a group of board members, faculty members, and parents asking the tough questions about our own beloved Burgundy and figuring out what we could do better and how to strive, how to write it down in concise to-do lists, and then challenge us and remind us about those things every 5 years to keep us moving forward. And that was so important. And then, towards the middle of my board service, I ended up as treasurer of the board, and because of the circumstances, I had to peel back the onion on the financial operations of the school. And at one point, I'm up in the administration's office, and I'm like, okay, so who deals with the individual teacher and programmatic budgets? And Van Deusen. It was amazing to me to hear that she did yet one more thing for the school that very few people knew about. She did it with grace. She never asked for additional recognition for doing all of these little things behind the scenes that have kept Burgundy a progressive school, true to its name, in looking at itself, striving to get better, keeping track of its money for the programs and the teachers, the classrooms, and the kids. We will miss Anne Van Deusen.
Hi, my name is Patrick Sansone. I graduated Burgundy in the class of 2013. I have many fond memories of Anne, but there's one that I want to share with you in particular. I was in fourth grade, and I was looking for a book to read, so I asked Anne for a recommendation. She asked me, what type of book do you want? And me, being in fourth grade, I was a little bit picky. I wanted an action book, but not too much action. I wanted a book with mystery, but not too much mystery. And no romance. Romance was gross to a fourth grader. I still believe in cooties. But that's besides the point. Anne not only knew every student by a first name basis, but she knew what book they wanted based on what they told her. She brought me a book, Among the Hidden by Margaret Peterson Haddix, and it was absolutely perfect. Anne, you taught me how to use Microsoft Word and not to use Wikipedia as a source to write a paper. You taught me how to use PowerPoint as well as to recreate my love for learning and reading. And for that, I thank you.
Since first grade, and I've known her for always knew what I wanted. She always knew what everybody wanted. Everybody's personality, everybody's passion. And she just made the school more lively.
Realize the time. Look on and make me wonder what I'm doing. Staying so far behind without you. You're gonna make me wonder what I'm saying.
I'm Wendy John, and Doug and I have two sons who went here, Dave, who graduated in 93, and Steve, who graduated in 97. They have their own words for Anne, and that's what we want to share with you today. Dave wrote, "There's a feature called the world tree that is common among many religions. The world tree, metaphorically, links the realms of heaven, earth, and the netherworld, and it represents the axis around which all else pivots. I believe this tree exists within every individual. The tree is healthiest inside those of us fortunate enough to grow up surrounded by loving family, friends, and mentors. Those with the added blessing of a Burgundy education grow an especially strong core of inner rims during those critical formative years. Within each of these rims, inside every student who attended Burgundy since Anne began her journey of service there in 1981, lies a living piece of Anne. Her spirit may be strongest in the fertile garden of the Burgundy library and campus. I know I will feel her every time I return. But she will also travel inside the world-centering core that lies within each of us. When I saw Anne at her retirement celebration in May, I immediately dashed over and gave her a big warm hug. Then I glanced down and see the sign around her neck that said, please, no hugs. Immediately, I felt two things. First, and strongest, was horrified remorse at having potentially caused Anne pain by my gesture, even as gentle as it was. This, however, was accompanied by a tiny twinge of triumph, for I had seen, if I had seen the sign beforehand, I wouldn't have gone for the hug. And my devious inner child was glad to have snuck one by. I apologized to Anne, of course. She gave me that classic, graceful Anne smile of hers, as if to say, it's okay, Davy. And the next words come from Steve, AKA Stevie, who graduated in 97. Anne Van Dusen was like an electric light, warm and glowing, illuminating everything and everyone fortunate enough to be near her. From reading circles held among the cramped and musty Dewey decimal stacks of the beloved old library tucked away in a side room of the loft in its 1980s gray-green carpeted days, to the youngster's guide through the modern, spacious, and computerized library she loved until this very year. Anne was a storyteller, an inspiration, a source of support, and a rarely flagging smile on which to anchor one's day. I cannot remember the first time I met Anne. It was 1988 and I was a boy of five. I'll wager few people of any age who had the honor of knowing Anne well remember first meeting her. Once you knew her, she was simply a constant, a pillar of the community if ever one lived. That was as true in the 1980s as it was when I last recall seeing Anne. I watched from several steps back as she excitedly showed my wife, herself an elementary educator, a new software program the students were using. She was as aglow in the second decade of the 21st century as she was all those years back when I myself was a young student under her loving care. And here, I realize that in fact my simile of the electric light is wrong, quite wrong even. For an electric light at some point ceases to shine. Anne will ever glow for those lucky enough to have known her.
Even me, I had to have my omelet. This was all on top of their full-time jobs, and it was only possible with their steady
I'm sure that you soon lost count of the miles and hours you spent traveling back and forth, but you made sure that Burgundy students all continued to get their turn, catching newts, watching the sunset from above, exploring Fern Valley, and thinking about their relationship with the universe. It was the Van Dusens who were at the core of keeping that place alive. They certainly have passed their love of the place along to the next generation of Van Dusen and Gorgiados, who have since put in their time hauling piles of leaves away from the building, cleaning out mouse nests, and replacing entire walls. Anne made it up to the Cove this past May for a quick visit. And so many people dread the colonial camp out. She was hoping to make it this May to come with Kate when she wanted to come so badly, and just only like maybe a few days beforehand decided she just really was not able to do that. She didn't want to be there. The camp out, the colonial camp out. As for the partnership I mentioned, isolation is a potential issue in any hardworking school for children. This room is full of educators, and you all know what I mean. You can't just tell a classroom of children, oh, just stand by, I'm just gonna go get something across campus or ask someone a question. We don't see that much of each other. You just kind of have to take it on faith that your colleagues are over there working just as hard as you, will help out when they can, that they understand more or less how you're feeling. This is also true when two workspaces are 100 miles apart. And I imagine it would also hold true for a resource person like a librarian. With appreciation to Robert Frost for his original words, I offer a slightly altered ending to his poem, The Tuft of Flowers, which I recommend to anyone. It starts off with a man feeling lonely as he shares a job with someone who works the same field, literally mowing it, but in a different shift, so they never see each other. Then he comes across a stand of flowers that the other person has spared, just because it's so beautiful. The beauty of the outdoors never failed to move in, in any season. The butterfly and I had lit upon, nevertheless, a message from the dawn. That made me hear the wakening birds around, and hear the long sigh of the spring to the ground, and feel a kindred spirit to my own, so that henceforth I worked no more alone, but glad with her. I worked as with her aid, and weary, sought at noon with her the shade. People work together, she told me from the heart, whether they work together or apart. I don't know if she really ever understood how to rest, but I hope she's resting now. Thank you.
I'm director of technology, and I worked alongside Ann for 9 years as part of the library technology team that she named Bibliotech. And as a way of introducing the faculty singer's song, I just wanted to share three of the many lessons that I learned from Ann in those years of working together. Lesson one. It is not just about the work, it is about the people. As we all know, Anne was a very disciplined and hard worker, but she cared even more about people, which she showed by regularly checking in about personal matters, by the many gifts she gave, which for me included one of those wonderful baby blankets when my grandson was born just over a year ago, and by thoughtful handwritten notes. I was especially amazed how Anne reached out to Austin as a surrogate parent to ease his transition from North Carolina to Alexandria. She did this because she cared so much about Burgundy that she wanted him to feel welcome here, and because she cared for him as a person, just as she cared for all of us. Lesson two, always make time for singing. Over the years, when rehearsals or hastily arranged the songs to be performed at the festival rites or other events, most of us in our busyness struggled to get there. But Anne was there faithfully and promptly. Singing was one of the many forms of celebration that were a priority for her. Lesson 3. Don't just teach about research and technology when you can also teach about history and justice. For many years in our study skills class, students chose one topic from a list of historical events about which they had to conduct research, write a script, and produce a video. One of those topics that I learned about for the first time from helping teach this class was the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire of 1911, in which 146 garment workers, mostly immigrant women between the ages of 16 and 23, lost their lives because the factory owners routinely locked the stairwells and the exits while they worked. Now we're going to call the faculty singers up at this time. I'm sure many of you know the story behind the song Amazing Grace, the amazing story, that the lyrics were composed by John Newton, who had worked for some years as a captain of a slave ship. During a storm at sea while transporting slaves, Newton experienced a life-changing moment of remorse and repentance, a powerful moment of grace that eventually led him to leave that work and to dedicate himself to opposing slavery. And I am sure that you would have liked to be here today to sing this with us, both for the beautiful music and the story behind it. It was our amazing grace to have had you among us.
Was great.
lucky to have had mom and dad as my parents. And I was always amazed at how amazing my mom was. And I'm reminded, even now, I'm surprised at how amazing she was. When you're mom, you don't always pay attention as well as you should. But I'm grateful for all of the memories, because I know that just because she isn't here, it doesn't mean that she won't live on in all of the things that she's given her children, and my children, and me, and the school. And so I just want to thank everybody for today and all of your thoughts.
Jan and Jim for letting us do this today, and everyone who's participated, and also Jan for saying those words, which really make a lot to all of us, Larry and the kids, and everyone, thank you. I think this last little quick excerpt of the reading encapsulates a lot of what Jan just said and pulls things together, and then Kathy Manley's going to lead us in song, because we're going to leave on an uptick and a joyful note today. I know Anne would very much appreciate that. This is a little excerpt from a poem that I've shared with Anne and the faculty once or twice over the years. It's by Edie Cummings. I thank you, God, for most this amazing. I thank you, God, for most this amazing day, for the leaping, greenly spirits of trees, and a blue, true dream of sky, and for everything, which is natural, which is infinite, which is yes. I who have died am alive again today, and this is the sun's birthday. This is the birthday of life and of love and wings. And this is the part that Anne really makes me think about. Now the ears of my ears awake, and now the eyes of my eyes are opened. God bless you, Anne.
Of Anne Anderson, who loves singing and rounds, I have been commanded for all time to make sure we keep singing rounds, right? So we will. We've already been doing it. So I think it's time to stand up. What do you think? She gave us an amazing song that I didn't know about. A lot of other people knew it, called This Pretty Planet. And it's, I found a wonderful YouTube recording that has singing, and the words will be up there. It's a slower version. It's a very beautiful sound. So what we're going to do is sing it one time, all together, in unison. All right? And then we're going to sing it in a round. So if you guys could take a mic, or take a group, like one of you take that mic over there. So we'll have three parts. This is part one. Okay? And a very big important thing at Burgundy is even if you feel like you can't sing, you don't have to worry about it, you just sing anyway. This is part two, and then you get better. And part three is over there. I have my Songbird colleagues here to help us. Are we on? So we can all sing together.
You're good.